Alien Worlds is a well-produced, interesting and beautifully made documentary series speculating on life on exoplanets and their alien biospheres. Each episode intertwines accounts from actual science with the application of that knowledge to fictional worlds that may exist beyond our solar system. But does the series hold up to closer scrutiny? How realistic are its depictions of living organisms and the ecosystems they live in? Let's find out. In episode 3, we are introduced to a world quite like Earth, but with significant differences. Eden, as it is called, is a planet circling a binary star consisting of a red and an orange dwarf. These kinds of stars are significantly less massive and dimmer than our own Sun, and the habitability of planets around these is usually unfavorable due to several key factors. First of all, the light and warmth supplied by a red or even a slightly more energetic orange dwarf is much lower and also peaks in less optimal frequencies. Second of all, the so-called Goldilocks or temperate zone within such a system must be much closer to the center, usually causing planets in that zone to be tidally locked. Finally, dimmer stars are also more unstable, especially in their early years, because they spin a lot faster, resulting in an expanded magnetosphere that is not as tight as, for instance, our Sun's. This leads to unpredictable bursts of solar activity and radiation, potentially stripping the innermost planets of their atmospheres. However, in this case, these common problematic factors are actually mitigated by the fact that the two stars of this system orbit very close to each other, and Eden around them both. Due to rotational synchronization between the star couple, their instability is significantly tamed, leading to quieter systems. And the combined strength of both stars also shifts the habitable zone further out, which is reflected in Eden's orbital period of 206 days, roughly half Earth's, and slightly less than Venus. Apart from not being tidally locked, it is even given a rotation period quite close to that of Earth. On top of all that, Eden has a markedly higher obliquity than Earth's, namely 40. Thus, almost doubling the axial tilt puts Eden at a greater angle towards stellar irradiation, leading to more light hitting the surface and thus driving photosynthesis and primary production. It also gives it much more pronounced seasons, especially at higher latitudes, with larger differences in amount of daylight and temperature between summer and winter. The vegetation on Eden is depicted as reddish or even black, which makes sense as the light influx there peaks in the red or even infrared range, whereas our Sun's peaks in the green range. Rightly so, the documentary makes a big point out of the importance of oxygen as a biomarker. This is because of the enormous amount of energy involved in oxygen-based metabolism. Any planet with an interesting biosphere, that is, one that rose above a microbial stadium, would be based on oxygen-producing primary production and oxygen-burning consumption. On Eden, this is amplified by its axial tilt and the thus more intense summers with longer days. In connection with this, Eden is also described as having significantly higher oxygen levels. In the documentary, Eden's situation is being compared to rainforests on Earth, where the higher levels of primary production lead to greater biomass and thus greater biodiversity. Oddly enough, however, it is then claimed that the higher energy influx on Eden makes for a more competitive biosphere, affecting the lifestyles of the animals living in its lush forests. In apparent support for this thesis, there's a segment on how guppies raised in a rainforest environment can shift reproductive strategies depending on circumstances. When it comes to reproduction, any life form is generally on a continuum of two main types. A creature that produces a multitude of smaller babies is called an R-strategist, and a creature that invests more time and energy on each individual of a smaller batch, a K-strategist. Remarkably, fish species like guppies are flexible enough to be able to apply both strategies. Under higher levels of predation, many small babies are produced, but in safer circumstances, more is invested in each baby, leading to fewer, larger ones. This is transferred to the fauna on Eden, and the first animal creatures we meet are the grazers. The species has a reproductive style with two stages, where the grazers asexually produce many small larvoids, which themselves fuse in pairs as a form of sexual reproduction. In itself, this is an interesting gimmick and mirrors the reproduction style of spore plants like ferns. But it is here that the message the series writers try to convey becomes muddled and unclear. To begin with, it is claimed that the grazers would have too little time for extensive mating. They supposedly have to be constantly on high alert because the high energy influx into the ecosystem makes it too dangerous to be in. Perhaps the idea is that a higher diversity of predators leads to more ways of getting killed. Nevertheless, there's only a single species of predator that we're presented with. The envisioned food chain goes as follows. The entire summer season, the grazers eat yellow food pellets produced by a fungus. The grazers are hunted by a predator, which they are pretty good at escaping from. By the end of the season, the fungus produces special orange pellets, which are extra attractive to the grazers. However, these orange pellets infect the grazers, making them lose their fear instinct and thus become easy prey for the predators. By eating an infected grazer, the predator falls ill itself and eventually dies. The infected corpses of the predators then provide food for a new fungus, and the cycle repeats. Surviving grazers die when the summer season ends, while the predators migrate away. Now, there are several major problems with this food chain. First and foremost, despite spending an entire segment on the importance of solar influx and Eden's greater levels of it, at no point in this food chain is there any primary production involved. All of the species in the chain are heterotrophic and none are autotrophic. This is an ecological perpetuum mobile. Just like an engine, you cannot keep it running without providing energy somewhere in the chain. It's like charging your electric car with a dynamo while driving. It doesn't work. This is especially baffling given how big of a point is made out of Eden's higher energy input. The documentary compares the symbiotic relationship with mutualistic ones known from Earth. However, there's nothing mutualistic about this, since this is clearly a form of parasitism. Another major problem is that the animals are assumed to sustain self-harming behaviors. In reality, natural selection would quickly put a stop to this. Grazers that like orange pellets will have shorter reproductive stages, and thus those who grow to dislike these will eventually thrive better, breaking the advantage for the fungus. And predators that catch and eat prey animals that appear sick and don't run away will likewise quickly be weeded out of the population. Furthermore, apart from the lack of autotrophy, it's hard to see how the amount of energy going around in this food chain could add up. We are led to believe that the corpse of a single predator can sustain a fungus an entire season while also nurturing as many grazers as possible, many of whom are eaten by predators. This makes no sense and would not work in real life. But there is a more sensible way to make this ecosystem work, though. Like on Earth, the fungi could live off plant debris and in addition use its mycelial system to supply plants with nutrients in exchange for carbohydrates or analog energy carriers. Additionally, the predators could be omnivores, as was already implied but never stated. This way, we can get another energy influx from primary production by the autotrophic plants. Furthermore, instead of making the deadly fruits visibly different, it could be turned into a lottery, allowing the grazers to balance out the chance of becoming infected against the payoff. And instead of losing their fear of predators, the grazers could only be marginally affected, just enough to be at a slight disadvantage, but still almost indistinguishable from their healthy peers. For the predators too, this would then become a lottery to be weighed against the benefits. Meat would provide an easily digestible and highly nutritious meal, but does come with a tiny risk. Even better, the predators could wait to feast on the grazers at the end of the season, when they all die anyway, or rather, the fungi could then reclaim some of the energy they invested. And instead of using the predators as a food source, the fungi could use them for wider distribution of their spores, since the predators are highly mobile and migrate constantly. They wouldn't even have to kill them, but simply exit the predators' bodies after some dormancy. All taken into account, this would actually lead to a truly mutualistic symbiosis of different species. A closer look at the anatomy of the animal species shown in this episode reveals that the producers took strong cues from what a general audience would expect of an alien creature. This generally needs to be something they're already familiar with, so they can empathize and relate to the story being told, but with a few twists added to make it more interesting. These two emotions being played at, empathy and curiosity, result in artistic liberties that really are a marketing strategy to appeal to as many people as possible. It could be lamented that commercial productions like this will tend to appeal to popularity and not always purely to what would be interesting from a scientific point of view. But I sympathize with the hard decisions the production team had to make within the medium's limitations. The different creatures are nevertheless beautifully designed and animated, and they function well as vehicles for telling a compelling science educational story. But expectedly, they're typical Frankenstein fusions, as I like to call it, combining superficial elements from different animals we already know from Earth. The grazers have a very similar body frame to a rabbit's or a large rodent's, but externally they are adorned with superficial elements taken from insects like silk moths, especially the antennae. The many mouth parts are also reminiscent of those of arthropods, and what appears to be composite eyes share clear similarities to those of a mantis shrimp. In itself, large, rounded, compound eyes make perfect sense for a creature that has to be watchful, as this type of eyes allows for looking in all directions simultaneously. This is one of the reasons it's hard to swat a fly, because they detect movement all around them. But assuming these are compound eyes, they get one important detail wrong: the pseudo-pupils. Compound eyes may appear to have a pupil, but this is merely an optical illusion, because the dark spot is just those ocelli that you look straight into, rather than their colorful, opaque sheaths. The mistake here is that the apparent pseudo-pupil of the grazers are not animated to constantly change position depending on the viewer's perspective, but remain fixed. In reality, looking at the grazer from the front, instead of this, you'd rather see this. The predator species has an even more familiar mammal-like body plan. It's again another fusion, looking like a hybrid between a monkey and a bat, but several features are taken from frogs, especially their extendable arms working like a prehensile tongue. Also like a frog are their eyes that, oddly enough, have horizontally elongated pupils. This is actually a common artistic technique to make something relatively familiar look more alien, but it does not necessarily make sense in this particular case. In camera-type eyes, pupils help moderate the amount of light that hits the light-sensitive retina. Elongated pupils have several advantages, most notably in low-light environments, since they allow more precise control of this, enhancing color vision and depth of focus. Eden's predator species is clearly a daylight hunter, though, and vertical pupils are actually better for detecting up and down movement, which you'd expect from an ambush predator hunting low to the ground, like this predator does. So even though it would make them look less alien, the eyes really ought to look like this. Horizontal pupils are more advantageous for a wider field of vision, typically needed in prey animals that need to be on constant alert to detect any movement in their peripheral vision. Prey animals like the grazers, for instance, except of course these don't have camera-type eyes. In fact, this touches on another issue I could find with this particular fauna, namely that the two species have completely different body plans. It is of course entirely plausible, and actually quite normal, that animals with radically different body plans inhabit the same ecosystems. Still, when designing alien faunas, it always adds an extra dimension of plausibility when there's some suggestion of a deeper, nested phylogeny of its member species. I, for one, always recommend to take a cue from Earth's diversity and its rich hierarchical structure. Well, that's all I had. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will probably also look at the other episodes soon. For now, thanks for watching, cheers and bye-bye!